So let's continue. We well, we and especially you have heard a lot already, and now the idea is that you hear some more. yeah, we Daniel especially has gone through all kinds of modeling and Bayesian network modeling and different ways of thinking and of accounting for information with different characteristics. Now we, of course, this is very important for our decision analysis and value of information analysis. But so to say, it is only about the first two branches of our pre-posterior decision analysis, which is a part of the value of information analysis. So it's the information type, direct, indirect, for instance, and the outcome, which can be probabilistic or, in the case that we have perfect information, it's rather deterministic. So we have, in this decision tree, we have covered the two branches. Or maybe even we have a look to the first lecture. So we have been, when we look to this flow chart here, we have been covering these aspects. And we somehow already worked with a structural reliability model even in the first day, but now we pose a little more light on the methods which are behind modeling the performance of a system in terms of the structural reliability and the structural system reliability. And we also look at this interface. How do we update our structural reliability and the structural system reliability? And there is, I will introduce the main aspects which need to be considered. So the first point is structural reliability. There's two systems, and the question is to you, what is the structural reliability, or where, to which type of structures you see here the structural reliability applies.
It is an indicator of the probability of failure.
Yes. Yes.
Sorry, asking the definition for structural reliability.
Yes, exactly, this was the answer to the definition, or one definition. But if you look at this, at this structure, this is a bridge. This is obviously an offshore wind turbine or offshore wind park. And top side where the conversion equipment is on. So to what? Yes, this is also an aspect we will consider. But to what parts of these structures the structural reliability applies?
The structure of the components, for example, if we have the gear, we have the.
Yeah.
We have all two different components that work together to make the structure. For example, in the bridge, we have the span, we have the beer.
Yeah. We have the cables.
We have the cables.
Yeah. Okay. So, well, this looks like this can be covered with the structural reliability. How about here, looking at the wind turbine?
The turbine blade supports structure.
Yep.
Then even the rotor itself.
Yeah, this is structural reliability, and or this belongs to a structure. Yeah. And how about the this part here, the machinery and the control unit? Is this structural reliability? Yeah, no, it isn't. And this is what we need to be aware of in structural reliability. It's about the structures, and it requires a special way of thinking to calculate the structural reliability, and it's different from the machinery reliability. So here we observe that this bridge and many other bridges, they are rather unique, although there are types like stable cable state bridges. So structural components and systems are unique. And what we are doing when we think of the probability of failure is that we look at failure mechanisms, and we often have extreme loadings, like here we have the traffic loads in combination with wind, for instance. And then there's an event which leads, which may lead to the situation that the loading exceeds the capacity, and then we have a failure. So we have basically we consider the loading and the resistance, and we have probabilistic models for the loading and the resistance, which are derived from data, and then we estimate the distribution parameters, and we calculate the probability that of that the loading exceeds the resistance. But this is different from what is called the classical reliability analysis. And this applies to machinery systems. Here, the situation is different. Here, I usually have a large number of components and of identical components. And I have statistics of component failures, and even of system failures. So I have data on time to failure, and then I can derive a model for the time to failure, estimate the distribution parameters, and then I have the statistics on the time to failure, and that's largely done in for machinery systems. So this can be found for trains, cars, for power plants.
This can also be done for structures, right? For structures, we can also just look at the time to failure. What is the problem then?
In case of varying load characteristic, if you're looking at just the time to failure, you could be wrong, because it has to be more like a dynamic risk assessment where you have to consider the load that caused that time to failure. So in case of a change in that load, then your analysis might just lead you to a very wrong conclusion.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, exactly. The problem is, for this classical reliability, we consider only one dimension, that is the time to failure, right?
Yes.
So we consider an entire population, where we assume that they have exactly the same boundary conditions, they are exactly the same. They have the same resistance, they have the same exposure to load, and that makes actually only seldom sense, even in the machinery parts of the offshore wind park. We could integrate individually the loading of a gearbox, for instance. But this is hardly done. All gearboxes are taken in one sack, and we consider this as just one population, and we make statistics in this population. That's a big difference between structural ability. There we separate the problem and separate generic parts that can be generally considered. So it's a question, I think Sebastian already did in some publications, when we apply the philosophy of structural engineering to classical reliability, normally you can gain a lot because you differentiate the loading, you differentiate the exposure of the different components, and you can make a much more differentiated judgment on these parts. Differentiate on the loading is the real thing.
Yeah, we can say that we, as the structural reliability engineers, researchers, we know much more about the failure and the damage mechanisms than usually the people from classical reliability engineering know. Probably most likely is that there's not a clear knowledge on exactly how the component fails and what is the mechanism behind. So there we are much better, the structural engineers and the reliability researchers and engineers. So, okay, these are the points. Maybe for wind turbine, this is not a classical structural reliability problem. Here it's rather an interaction between the structure and the machinery. So normally our loads are rather environmental loads we have to consider. But here it's a control system, so it's variable loading and the control, how this is done, how the rotor is turned and the blades are turned, pitched. This influences the loading. Okay. Let's go on. I have a lot of interesting things we could talk about, but let's be a little bit more focused. So when we look at this equation, R minus S. Lower or equal than zero, we can reformulate this as an integral of the CDF times the PDF, the CDF of the resistance times the PDF of S, and we integrate over from minus infinity to infinity over all the random variables. This can be in a PDF. Diagram. We can visualize it like this, or we can introduce here the joint or density function of the probability of failure. This looks like this, and we may have the situation that we have only one random. Variable here, but this is a large simplification, and I think this goes to the discussion in the lunch break. We have to be very careful with such analyses. It may also be possible to take this expression and to derive a safety margin. So this is a simple random variable calculation. M is defined as R minus S, and then if we integrate our density here of the safety margin, then we have the probability of failure, and this is the integration from here to infinity provides the probability of survival. So if we can draw or we can visualize this equation here with the two PDFs, or we could draw it like this, that we have a joint probability density function of on one dimension there is the resistance, and on the other one there is the loading. Anybody knows what the difference between this diagram and this diagram is? What do we neglect here in regards to this? Exactly. Super. This is the, we neglect that we have dependencies, that we may have dependencies, which come through through common influencing random variables. So the most general way of writing the structural reliability problem is that the probability of failure is defined as the integral over the joint probability density function in the area where the limit state function becomes lower or equal than zero. So this we need to integrate over this area. And there are several ways of solving this problem. Here we have FORM and SORM. That's the first order reliability method and the second order reliability method. The first order reliability method relies on a linearization of the limit state function, which is here, g, and then finding out the closest distance to the origin, and this in the standard normal space. And then the idea of the second order reliability method is I do not approximate with the linear function, but I can take a second order function to approximate the limit state function. This is some standard solution methods, especially FORM is often used. I don't want to go into detail with the FORM and the SORM methods. You can find it in structural reliability books and of course in almost any lecture note. But let's have a closer look to simulation methods. And the procedure of working with the simulation method is that you generate realizations of your random variables for every simulation or for every realization you compute the value of the limit state function. And then you count basically how often you observe a failure and divide it by the m realizations. And then you have the probability of failure. So it's rather, this looks rather straightforward. But maybe some more background on why it works. And it works. Because we have this expression here, it's rather something which is also close to our observation. We can calculate the expected value of a function g of x with m samples. So we calculate our limit state function and sum it and divide it over the number of samples. So this is one approximation which may be rather straightforward. But now let's get back to the probability of failure problem. So we have been writing it like this. We integrate here over the area where the limit state function is lower or equal than zero. But the problem is that we don't know this area. So that's why we need to replace here the boundaries with, it would be good if we just could sample from minus infinity to infinity, so there's no limitations. And in order to achieve that, a indicator function is introduced. Basically, it's one if there was a failure and zero if there was no failure. So that's the very straightforward mathematical formulation, and then we arrive at this formula. So, and this is the background for the Monte Carlo simulation. A few more words on the steps to perform the Monte Carlo simulation. One point is the generation of the random samples. Here, it's not such a problem anymore, but in the beginning of the development of computer technology, then the generation of random samples was a problem. Here we need to be aware of that there is an algorithm which where the randomness is which provides a randomness without short periods of repetition. So you can find this in the software description. If you use MATLAB, then you can look in the random number generators, and they give the seed. So how many really random samples are generated. Today is more the problem that the random number generators may have compromised by some people who are interested in regenerating the random samples, so that's not random anymore, but it looks like random. Okay. This is, so we need random numbers, and the random generators, they are usually providing numbers between 0 and 1. And how do we come to our distribution function? This is done with the inverse transformation method. We have here our uniformly distributed random numbers between 0 and 1. And if you take then the inverse cumulative distribution function, we can generate samples which have a distribution like we want. Of course, in Python and MATLAB, you can very easily with one command generate for many distribution types directly the realizations. But that's basically behind what is already implemented in MATLAB, they may need to implement this method is if you want to generate correlated samples. Then you should use the inverse transformation method, or you may come across a distribution function which is not implemented in MATLAB or in Python or any other programming language, then you can work with the inverse transformation method. What we always need to be aware of is the precision of our calculation. And here, the rule is that, and there's a derivation for it, the standard deviation of a Monte Carlo simulation equals the square root of the probability of failure divided by the number of samples after convergence. So this means if you are calculating a probability of failure in the order of 10 to the power of minus 3, and you want to calculate it with the coefficient of variation of 0.1, then you need 10 to the power of 5 samples. If you want to have for the same a precision of 1% coefficient of variation, then you need 10 to the power of 7 samples. Very important. And this goes for, so the limitation is Monte Carlo simulation. If you have any updating in your code or any intersection operations, then this does not hold necessarily anymore. It depends on how your intersection and union operators, how they are working. So we can use Monte Carlo, and there's a rather straightforward mathematical operation for shifting the integration area to minus infinity to infinity. So it's very easy to do, to implement, but the price is the computational effort. And here most of the samples are useless. They're here in the safe region, but we are basically would like to know this region here. But of course, here is the highest probability density, and there's the most samples, and most of the samples are useless. So in order to overcome that, there is, this is here also introduced, very basic. We could try to have a different sampling density, or we would like to decouple the joint probability density function of our random variables from the sampling density, so that we can sample more here in this region. And this can be introduced with the random variable V and a joint probability density function. And now the we can do still Monte Carlo, but we are much more precise. It doesn't go any further. So this is the hint that the basic idea is to decouple the sampling density from the probability density function of our random variables. And over the decades, there has been there is a lot of methods which have emerged. They are called adaptive sampling, spherical sampling, it's subspace sampling, and they are all there basically to overcome the resource challenge we have with Monte Carlo simulation. There's also response surfaces and surrogate models. That's all basically the idea to overcome the computational burden of Monte Carlo simulation. Does anybody know the criteria from computer science whether a problem can be solved or not? what is the criterion from computer science for solvability of a problem or a problem which cannot be solved? Anybody recognizing these letters? Anybody knows the meaning? P and NP? In computer science, a problem is considered to be solvable if it can be solved in polynomial time. If a problem cannot be solved in polynomial time, it's determined as NP problem, so not in non-polynomial time. So this is a problem which, for instance, leads to the situation that there is an exponential growth of the problem, which requires an exponential time to solve. So this is a distinction of computer science, and this is what Daniel referred to in the last lectures. So yes, the decision trees can explode exponentially, and then we have a problem, and this is the problem. It is considered by computer science not solvable. Not completely solvable. Of course, for very small problems, we can find a solution. Okay, so this is the distinction by computer science. So anybody knows the growth of the computational power over the last 50 years? What is that called? That's the Moore's law, right? And what is that? What shape does it have?
Yeah, exponential.
Exactly. So the computational power grows exponentially. Well, I didn't have the chance to confront computer science people with this problem. And why is there this distinction if there was exponential growth of the computational power? Okay. So somehow to the P and NP problem, there should be a few more boundaries, also temporal boundaries. Because if we take away the temporal boundaries, then we say, okay, the computational power, it grows exponentially. So why there is this distinction? Anyway, if we want to solve very complex problems today, we need to do this, but maybe not in the future. Anyway, good. Several solution methods form for structural reliability, SORM. So this is approximate methods. And they are precise for normal distributions, especially the form. Anytime you have some skewed distributions, some extreme value distributions, then form may not be precise anymore. You have to be very careful. And form may get also, if you have a large number of random variables, it may not work anymore. If you take Monte Carlo, it's independent of the number of random variables. It's independent of the distributions. It will give you a precise solution if you have enough samples and you can computationally handle the problem. So this is the important points. And then there's all kinds of schemes of making a Monte Carlo simulation more efficient. So this is the main points here for structural reliability. We have for the structural reliability quite some challenges because we have very small probabilities of failure. Structures do not fail very often. This is good. For the computation, especially with Monte Carlo, as the precision depends on the probability of failure. And the resources depend on the probability of failure. This is quite a challenge. And another challenge is that we have systems. And an R minus S for one component, a beam, maybe solvable, and there's enough modeling options. But when we go to such a system, this is extremely complex. Okay. For the structural reliability, there's software packages. So of course you can work with programming language, but there's also Struhl and Comre, UK Lab, Zara. Zara is one tool which is connected to finite element software, also by Cervenka and Kalrel and Ferrum, that's from the University of California in Berkeley. There's various kinds of methods and also various kinds of software packages, mainly coming from the academic field, but there's also a few commercial softwares available. Structural system reliability. Why do we talk about systems? The very important point here is the determination of target reliabilities and the risk analysis. So the determination of target reliabilities we find in the Eurocode 0 and in the JCSS probabilistic model code basis of design. And they are determined with a risk analysis as part of a decision analysis. Jochen is the expert here. And so if you have a risk analysis, then we have a probability times consequences. So, and if we, and the largest risks are associated to the situation of system failure. So there's not so big consequences if here in the bridge, maybe there's failing one subcomponent, and then maybe one lane is just one lane is blocked, and the other lanes are open. It can operate. There will be a few more traffic jams around, but this is not large consequences. There is very large consequences in the case where the bridge fails, because then, well, the failure itself may involve quite some consequences. So the bridge is gone basically. But there may also be some fatalities and injured people. And then here, in this case, that must be the Störebelt or the Öresund bridge. I don't know, maybe the Störebelt bridge. Then the connection between some islands of Denmark is gone. And even the highest points in Denmark, they would be gone, that's here. So the highest points in Denmark is the top of the pylons of the Sturebelt Bridge. There's no hill higher than that in Denmark. Okay, there's large consequences for system failure. So the target reliabilities, they are determined on the basis of the system failure. And we, of course, there's some other aspects in systems. So system design is very important because it should not be the way. A system should be somehow be robustly designed. It should not be the way that if one component fails, maybe a minor component, this should lead to the system collapse. So that's why system reliability is important. Some basic modeling of systems. Logical systems. We can have serial systems and parallel systems. And a serial system is like a chain. If one component fails, the system fails. If you have maybe 10 chains and every chain is a component, this is an example for a parallel system. So you have 10 chains and one chain is rupturing, then the rest, the 9 chains are holding. And this is an example of a parallel system. And then there's a mixture of these two systems. So for a serial system and a parallel system, we can calculate the probability of failure. For a serial system, it's the union of the failure events. And this corresponds to this expression here. So we take the minimum of the limit state functions. So we may have here 6 limit state functions. And if we do the sampling, Monte Carlo sampling, so and calculate the limit state values, and we take the minimum out of these 6 limit state functions and calculate then the probability that this is smaller or equal than 0, then we have the probability of system failure. This can also be achieved with this operation. For a parallel system, we have the intersection operator or the maximization operator in terms of the limit state values. Here we can work with any correlation. And there are simplifications for the case where there's no correlation between the failure events. And the simplification if there's full correlation between the failure events. But you can find this elsewhere. If we only have normal distributed random variables or normally distributed safety margins, then the probability of system failure for a logical system, for a serial system, and for a parallel system can be calculated with the multivariate normal distribution. And betas, so that's the reliability indices for each of the component, and then a correlation matrix of how each component is correlated with each other. So this is logical system modeling. Pardon?
It was rather briefly introduced.
Yep.
It's good. We have a lot of time for that.
For the topic of structural reliability, structural system reliability, and updating, there could be 3 lectures. So this is the version putting it into one lecture.
You should ask when you don't understand something.
Yeah. So this is another kind of system modeling, and it goes to a publication of Daniels. And Daniels has published about the statistical theory of the strength of bundles of threads. That's the cotton industry. Yeah, for the cotton industry, they were interested in the reliability of strands, of accumulation of threads in a cable of wool. Remarkable in this publication is that it has been published, and then there were public comments to the research work. So when we publish, we first have the review process and we get the comments, and then the article is published and the comments are not public. But here, if you find this article, you see also comments by colleagues of Daniels. Okay. So what is the Daniels system? It's a bundle of strands, and this is represents a parallel system. But additionally, he found expressions which take into account the behavior of the components. So whether they behave somehow somehow ductile, so that after the maximum of the strength maximum is reached, that they can still carry some load, or the case that they react brittle, so after reaching the maximum the capacity is gone. So this is the basic idea, and then there is for these cases approaches how to calculate the probability of system failure. If you have a ductile system, so that means we have some capacity after failure, then it's the sum of the resistances minus the system loading. Rather simple, straightforward. For the case that there's a brittle failure, so that means there's no capacity, we have here a maximization operation which takes into account the number of components, and then there's this expression multiplied with the realization of the resistance, and we take the maximum out of this multiplication, and then it's again minus the system loading. And this provides the probability of system failure if the components behave ideally brittle. So, structural system reliability with varying number of components. So let's have a look at this. So we have we just saw how a series system can be calculated, a parallel system can be calculated, and a special cases of a parallel system, if we consider also the component behavior, ductile and brittle, we have the Daniels system modeling. So So the assumptions here is that all the components have the same reliability, and there's no correlation between the component failures. So I'm adding to a system one component with the same reliability. And this is actually from Golewitzer and Rakwitz, who have been working with the Daniels system modeling, and to an extent which I did not show. So, but if we increase the number of components here for an ideal series system, we see that the system reliability, yeah, that's the system reliability here, it decreases. If you take an ideal elastic brittle system, so a brittle Daniell system, the probability of system failure does not change, or the reliability does not change largely. It drops a little and then goes a little up. If we have an ideal parallel system, then the structural reliability largely increases with the number of components. And if there was an ideal ductile system, then still a quite steep decrease of increase of the structural reliability. So this is a summary of what we have just gone through. So now we vary the failure correlation, and if you think of a chain and you have one case where there's no correlation and you have one case where all the components are fully correlated, so that the correlation means there's dependencies, so they somehow may produce with the very same resistance properties, and the loading is fully correlated because I'm taking a chain in my hands and I'm making it straight. In this way, there's a full correlation of load. Yeah? If I have more strength than in all components, the load will go up. And if I release a little, then there will be less. But it's in all components. It's not somehow varying for each component. So the loading is fully correlated. And let's say the resistance is fully correlated. This is one case. And then the failure is also fully correlated. This is one case. And the other case is that it's somehow random. So we can imagine this is a chain I'm holding, but there's 10 of, okay, depends on the number of components. Let's say I have two components in my hand, but there's 8 components left. So 8 people from you are also coming to the chain, and they are doing some random movements. So that will lead to random load in the chain. And then we also assume that the resistance, so the production of the chains, chain members, chain components, was completely random. It's also distributed and it's not correlated. So this is two cases. So and each of the components has the same reliability. So the distribution of the loading and the resistance is the same, but it's not correlated. So we cannot say the one realization, if I have a higher realization of the resistance for one component, it must not be that there's a higher realization of the loading in the other component. Yeah, that's randomness and that's uncorrelated probabilistic properties. So taking these two examples, an uncorrelated chain with 10 components and a correlated chain with 10 components. For which loading or for which system the probability of failure is higher? Pardon? It's a series system. Yes, this is right. We are in the context of a series system. And the question is, I'm varying the correlation between the component failures. And for what situation the probability of system failure is higher? For the case of no correlation or for full correlation? Okay. Yeah. So we have an ideal series system, and here we have the case of no correlation, and we have a low reliability and a high probability of failure. And if we have a high correlation, then we see that the probability of system failure is lower and the reliability is higher. It's the other way around for ideal ductile Daniell system. And for the case of an ideal elastic brittle Daniell system, this, yeah, first the system reliability drops and then it's, it increases. And what we also see here is if all the components are correlated, then the system behaves basically like one component. So the system reliability here is equal to 2, and 2 is the component reliability. Okay. So the system reliability depends on the type of the system, the reliability of the components, the number of the components, and the dependencies. So this is main influencing factors. Yeah, let's think about a little. Let's think a little about system reliability. We have, for instance, in nuclear power plants, a requirement of a redundancy of 4. So the redundancy is required. If we now think of the system reliability, what can it mean, and is the redundancy requirement somehow sufficient or not? So, for instance, I've seen cases where, yeah, there's a redundancy requirement of 4. So we put 4 of these emergency power generators. You just put it side by side by side. So, okay, but here we have, we say it's in at least in 2 different rooms, and they have put identical generators in one room and identical generators in the second room. So what can we say about the power supply reliability? So the power supply works if one of the generators produces power.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a parallel system.
The components are correlated in this case.
Yeah.
So redundancy is not 4, but
yeah, the power. Yeah, exactly. Basically, the 2 parallel systems. We have for each room we have a parallel system, and they are fully correlated. So the system reliability equals the component reliability, the reliability of one emergency generator. So it goes in the direction. It must be, yeah, the requirement that it must be 4 emergency generators, but the system reliability is not a parallel system of 4 because 2 are correlated. And well, this is a little compromising the safety. And there, of course, it depends on the scenario, but if the scenario is flooding of a room, then they are also fully correlated. Or if you think of deterioration of the of aging of these power supply generators, it's the same. They can be fully correlated. It may be the same aging mechanism which leads to failure of this power supply.
Common cause effect. Everything that is correlated could be they all depend on the same fuel tank.
Yeah.
This
common
cause effect when you do traditional failure tree analysis, it's very hard to consider. Find many failure tree analysis that would not consider this. It's just two probabilities and then they add on.
Okay.
I think in the entire system reliability topic, what we just heard the last 3 quarters of an hour, it's very important that we traditionally have all these tools developed in the context of a structural reliability analysis, where failure is the event, but we can combine these all kinds of events either as an intersection or as a union. So the intersection being the parallel system, the union being the serial system, right? So especially in the context of inspection and new observations, actually an observation of that some value is larger or smaller than the threshold, it's also an event. And then we have to represent a union of different inspection events, for instance. Then we can use exactly the system reliability problems. We can use form analysis. We can explicitly consider the correlation, because normally when we have several observations, they're also correlated to each other, and that makes the system reliability so appealing for our problem, for inspection, maintenance, and value of information. And then, of course, when we relate it to structures, it's important that a serial system does not always have to look like a chain. So it's just all combinations that you have one failure that leads to collapse of the entire system. And that's a simple truss system that is statically determined. So all statically determined systems that depend on the functionality of each single element are a serial system. Even so, they don't look serial at all, but they're a serial system. And all statically indeterminate systems, when we have a yielding material, like steel, they are in principle a parallel system.
Or a Denier system. That's thank you for switching to the next slide.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. This is the most important points. Back to structural reliability. Updating of structural reliability. This is the base theorem written with events. And here also with the total probability theorem to calculate the probability of A, which is symbolized here. So with discrete probabilities, and if we work with Bayesian networks and we have discrete probabilities, this is the, so to say, simple formulation. But we can also write, we have seen this already by Daniel, we can determine the posterior probability density function by multiplying the likelihood and the prior probability density functions, and then integrate. But this expression is basically there for normalizing the surface under the function, under the probability density function to 1. So we don't have to solve this integral, or we, like Daniel wrote, there was a proportionality operator here. So this function is proportional to this product. This would be Bayesian updating for continuous random variables, and we also can formulate Bayesian updating for the parameters of random variables. So that means we may have a random variable where the parameters, like the mean and the standard deviation for a normal distribution, they are somehow also following a distribution, and then we can update the distributions of the parameters. And this is the formulation here. Yeah, in short, what is happening if we work with distributions? And we may have a prior distribution like this, and the likelihood, which is which has rather a low probability density. So we could say this yeah, likelihood is more the information is more imprecise because the standard deviation is larger. Here the prior information has a lower standard deviation, so it's more precise. So the posterior will be close to the, here in this case, more precise information. The other way around, if we have a prior, which is rather wide, where the density is rather wide, so no high density, low information content, and we have likelihood, which has a low standard deviation, then again the posterior follows the more precise information, and this time it's likelihood, not the prior. So this is what we need to be aware of when we work with Bayesian updating. And sometimes we need to ask ourselves, is our measurement, our likelihoods really somewhat comparable with our prior information, or are the prior information are more comprehensive and we just have a special case? And it may, so it's also some thinking about the boundaries when we update. Okay, so we have numerical approaches for solving the updating, also the updating of events. And this is what you also should know. There is something like analytical solutions if the prior and the posterior distribution is of some special families. So that's the concept of the conjugate priors. You find it in textbooks. And there can be a straightforward analytical formulation for that. So when we only look at the updating, we take NDT reliability modeling, or the inspection modeling from the lecture from Daniel, so we can determine a probability of indication curve, and we can describe the event of indication or no indication in dependency of the defect size. Then we can calculate we can calculate conditional probabilities, and these conditional probabilities are then calculated with Bayesian updating, like it was written for events, and or it may be rewritten by the definition of the conditional probability of events, and this can be implemented in Monte Carlo simulation. So we need to know here what does our indication refer to. It refers to damage or failure, a component failure. Then we can update the probability of damage with the inspection outcome or the indication outcome. And we should be aware of, and if you draw a decision tree, you should be aware of that you can update with a no indication event and with an indication event. It's both. So yeah, for damage and failure, this is the options. And this is the example for updating the probability of damage with the no indication information. We may have a limit state function of a damage with a model uncertainty relating to the damage resistance and a model uncertainty relating to the damage loading. So that's an easy extension from R minus S to describe a damage of a component. it's important to hear that we describe the event of no indication. And so we are in the context that we are measuring on a structure and we have a prior model. So we know the probability of that there is a damage, and we also know the distribution of the damage size. So, and that's why we need to calculate the probability of indication here in this way. It is dependent on the realizations of the damage. So we go in with the distribution of the damage and go into our, I have it in the example then, or maybe there's a sheet left. Yeah, there's a sheet. Okay, so that's the indication. And this is the damage size D. And yeah, that's the probability of indication and dependency of D. So the point is that we have a random variable corresponding to this D, which goes into our structural reliability analysis. And somehow this random variable D has a density. And we need to go in with each realization of this density to calculate the probability of indication. And this is basically this expression here, which is then goes in the inverse CDF of the normal distribution. And here this is a, I think, uniformly distributed random variable. I thought it was somewhere there. Okay, maybe on another slide. So this is our limit state function for modeling this event. And it's dependent on our prior model. This is the important thing. Yeah, and then the, yeah, just a moment, yeah. And so here, if this is smaller or equal than zero, it's another Monte Carlo simulation. You will get then the probability of no indication in this case. Yeah.
So when I read the paper in which that definition was derived, it wasn't very much explained how to get to that expression, and I didn't get exactly why we do it that way to subtract the standard normal.
Yeah, well, the derivation can be found in Hong, 1997.
I read it and it didn't, well, probably it's because I didn't understand it, how he did it, but is it any logical explanation behind the...
Yeah, there's a derivation on getting out this formula, so that's mathematics.
Yeah.
And it's more comprehensively described in Hong, 1997. You can just Google for that. but the somehow logical explanation is that we have an indication event. We need a limit state function. And the probability of indication or no indication depends on the damage state of our structure. But we know the damage state of our structure. This is our prior model. So this is the kind of the logical explanation. Yeah. Okay, yeah, thanks, Lija. Okay, but maybe let's discuss about 2 points here. This point of the, that's the so-called, often referred to as the POD curve. More precisely, it models the indication. So let's first discuss about this point. What value do we have here? One? Yeah. And why do we have this here?
We don't take the whole distribution of the active part before, we just cut off the threshold, so that why we don't reach to one.
This can be a reason, but let's assume we have an extremely large damage, but still the probability of indication of that damage is not one. Why? Yeah, it can be the detection system, it can also be the operation. It's often the operation, it's the human errors. So even if the detection system may be reliable, there may be human errors which lead to the situation that it may never be exactly one. How is such a curve derived?
Experiments with a reference?
Yep. It's called round robin tests. It's experiments, and there's round robin tests. And there's even standards for that. Especially in aviation, when there's a new method, then there's tests in different laboratories with different teams using the same technology, and blind test specimens where they don't know what to detect. They just take the technology, different teams in different laboratories, and then it is counted who had a success detecting this defect and who not, and different defect sizes. So, and this covers, this is established, and it covers a lot of uncertainties, or it's very comprehensive in covering the uncertainties of the operators and even different operators' teams, even other laboratories, but also specifically of the technology, the measurement uncertainty is covered. So there is a measurement process. Strain gauge, you are measuring a voltage difference because of a resistance difference, and this is amplified. So it's an electrical process, and you can model this probabilistically, and then you get out the measurement uncertainty. And for all other measurement processes, it's a conversion of electrical and mechanical units and so on. So you can model this process, and every technology will have a variation of the outcome. So it's the uncertainty related to the measurement process, to the human performance, to the operation. So this is quite comprehensive, covered here in the determination of the PUD. So when we look here at this point, well, there is a zero. So so that's the probability of indication, yeah, given d equals zero. What is this?
False alarm.
Yeah, that's the probability of false alarm. Yeah, will this be zero? Will this be zero? No. So if we start the diagram with zero, then we have the probability of detection given a defect, which is by definition the POD. And if we start by zero, we have also included here the probability of false alarm. So there must be a finite value here. It should not be zero. Okay. Okay. So, well, the difference between this slide here and this slide here is that there is an index S here. And this refers to information I may have on system level, not on component level, for a inspection. I have very local information, but I may also have information which refer to the complete system. Anybody has an example?
The vibration properties probably.
Yep.
They are yep. Model of the global behavior of the structure.
Yep. Super.
Can you repeat?
The vibrational properties of
yep. Dominic, when do we have the next coffee break?
No.
No? Okay. Okay, well, we I think I may finish in 10 minutes. Yeah. Okay, fine. Yeah, well, and regarding the coffee breaks, well, I cannot keep this secret anymore. So you can get real espresso here at this machine. Yeah.
You can do it ourselves?
Yeah, you just have to ask for. No, well, and not by ourselves, but yeah. We can ask for that. Okay. What did we talk about? Information on system level. Right, something based on vibration information, and there's a huge field in structural health monitoring. I'm looking to Michael Todd, working with vibration analysis and determining damage indicators. So this is the information we have on system level, here on structure and system level for a bridge. The vibration is caused by the complete structure. Any other ideas of information on system level?
Survival of a load event.
Pardon? Survival?
Survival of a certain load?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's proof loading. Okay. Yep, super. So here, yeah, we need to update on system level, so we may update the system damage state, or it may also be the system failure event. But here, very careful modeling is required here. So we need to put then together the system modeling, yeah, the logical system modeling or the Daniel system modeling, together with the updating. And of course, we need for our indication event, we would need to develop a limit state function like we had for the inspection. So for the proof loading, it would be rather the system, and now not with the loading due to the to the wind, waves, our environment, but now with rather. Rather certain loading for the proof loading. So this, there will be only very low uncertainties related to the proof loading load, obviously. Okay. Then there is. Okay, 10 minutes. We can also exploit here for structural health monitoring a property of the model uncertainties. So, for understanding, we are leaving now the indications by proof loading, which is survival, or by an inspection, which may detect the damage. We now think of model uncertainties. So what is a model uncertainty? Anybody knows? Anybody can explain?
For example, you assume a straight wave distribution of certain components of whiteboard distribution, but actually it's not really fit to whiteboard distribution, so it's causing problems.
Anybody else?
Model uncertainty would be. Our models are not certain to begin with. I mean, we make many assumptions. We establish bias distributions.
Yep.
We idealize the probability distributions using theoretical distributions that we know of. For example, a random variable may not actually be following a normal probability distribution, but that's how we idealize it. So it imparts certain modeling errors.
Yeah, okay, there may be also model uncertainties for probabilistic modeling. But let's change the context and say we have a finite element model predicting the, let's say the failure load. Yeah.
I mean, maybe define it as a model uncertainty.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
It's
yeah. Yes, 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 yes. Okay, so let's say our finite element model, we predict the failure load of a beam. Yeah, and then I can calculate days, weeks, months, and find out that the failure load is maybe 10. So how do I determine the model uncertainty?
Experiments.
Yes, exactly. So I do 10 experiments or 20 experiments, and each of the experiments will lead not exactly to what I calculated, 10, but there may be a variation, and it comes to due to the assumptions you have described and simplifications of our models. So in order to account for the precision of our model prediction, finite element model, I can do experiments and I can forecast the precision of the model. So there will be somehow a distribution. It can be, very precise models may have even a negligible model uncertainty, but usually And especially for fatigue modeling, the model uncertainty is rather large or high. So, okay. So I have a prediction and I have these 10 experiments. So now I'm taking one of these specimens. So I've had, or I make 20 new specimens. And I consider just one of the specimens. Does the distribution of the model uncertainty apply here, or can we play, so to say, a little trick? Do we understand a little more? So, or maybe I'm, yeah, so again. One prediction with the finite element model, 20 experiments, and the difference between the prediction and the real distribution is calculated with the model uncertainty. Now it's just enough to cast one more beam. What can we say about this beam? Will it? Is the distribution of the model uncertainty still applicable to this one beam?
Maybe it means past observations. I mean, there are too many experiments for structural members that you account for, so we could use.
Yeah, maybe that goes in the right direction.
With that, the constraints you mentioned, you only have kind of one dot to trace the variation between the prediction and the experimental results.
Yeah.
So you need to modify also the finite element conditions to predict different points.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. This goes in the right direction. So you could measure. You could do some measurements at the one beam you are considering. And where will it lead to if we measure? What will we observe in and try to connect it with the model uncertainty? Okay, the answer is the new beam will be a realization of the model uncertainty, like all the other beams have been for finding out the distribution. But we have to find, it will be a realization, but we have to find out the realization. We don't know. That's why we can measure. And we may not measure as precise as in our laboratory experiments. It may be an in situ beam. That's why we have here a measurement or SHM uncertainty. But we will find out the realization of the model uncertainty, because it's very similar to determining the model uncertainties. So then we can exploit this property thinking of all possible realizations and multiplying it with the probability density. Then we are per definition at the expected value of the model uncertainty. But we may have here some additional SHM uncertainties. But of course, it must not be that we find the expected value, because there was a variation. So it can basically be any realization we need to find out. But it is a way of predicting what we can expect from a measurement. And well, this is rather crude modeling, but we can think of, we could find out this realization, and then our component behaves as designed, or even better. Or it may be the case that we find a realization, a high realization of the model uncertainty, and it's the loading model uncertainty. So there is an unexpectedly higher loading, but it's still covered in our distribution. It can happen, and if we find it, we may do something like strengthening. So then we can distinguish between two ranges of realizations of model uncertainties, and can connect this to consequences, to costs, in the context of decision analysis. Okay, so this was the last point of modeling. Yes, there is... Yes?
I have a question. Model uncertainty is often very challenging because in the experiment we are only able to measure all the input of the models, not directly but only indirectly. And if, for instance, take your example about the finite element model, then we want to determine the model uncertainty of this finite element model. But in order to do that, we have to do a model calculation for given material properties, for instance, and for given loads.
Yeah.
So we actually have even to represent the real material distribution, the spatial distribution in the entire element somehow. But what we can do, the only thing we can do, we can make a little sample test from the specimen and put this as an input. So actually the difference between the experiment and your modeling calculation does not only include the uncertainty about the model, but also the uncertainty between your material measurement you have in your experimental specimen and the real property all over the place in your specimen. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's a big problem. So normally when we make this experiments, and the experiments are very expensive, in order to find out the model uncertainty, for instance, of this very nice finite element programs for the plate buckling we use for offshore platform design. It's very interesting to know the model uncertainty but how do we measure the material properties? We don't know that. So the model uncertainty that we can find out in these kind of experiments includes the model uncertainty and the material uncertainty. And that's rather tricky, right?
Yeah, well, when in the specifics, modeling specifics.
And then when we make the reliability analysis with our model uncertainty, and we explicitly take into account the material uncertainty besides of that, then we actually double count some uncertainty.
It can be that it is. That can be happen, but the determination of the model uncertainties is a little more complicated than I just outlined. So you can have also a finite element model, a probabilistic finite element model, and you predict the failure load with the distribution.
Yeah.
And then you have the distribution in the experiments. But I understand your point. It's very important that we are aware of the boundaries of the tests of the model uncertainties.
Right.
And reality. It's well, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so to finish and to be able to get to the coffee break, we can have indications, and we work then with Bayesian updating likelihood functions or limit state function, which are modeling our indication event to update the structural reliability. We may update on component level, but there's also a structural health information on system level, like proof loading, like vibration-based methods, damage indicators, which are relying on a distributed sensor system. So we also are confronted with the system reliability and the updating of the system reliability. And then there's also the point of exploiting the model uncertainties in a way that we can think of a structure is a realization of a model uncertainty. Okay, thank you for your attention. I think we make a break and then we can continue our discussion, and I have also an example. So we have been going to structural reliability analysis with different methods, forms from Monte Carlo. Then we observed, okay, this is fine, but just for one component. We real-world systems have a lot of components, so we also need on top of that the structural system modeling. And then this is what we have been building up in the last 1.5 days. We have structural information. We have an idea how we can model these structural information. And one of the essence of the value of information analysis is that we are coupling our structural performance model and the SHM performance model, because the value of the information will be somehow determined of in a way the information is used for either getting better knowledge about the performance of a real world system which we are describing with our models. So this could be in terms of risk reduction, or we can better plan our actions so that we in a way that we have to intervene less to make the system perform. So this could also see that this is a kind of a better knowledge of our real world system, and it may be related to the actions we are planning. So I have now here a very simple system. Some of you I recognize two who may know this problem already. Maybe there's one or two more. But it's a simple system. It's one of the simplest systems we can think of. It consists of two components. Yeah? One component would not be a system, but two is a system. So let's start with this and our system performs as here described. We have a damage and the model uncertainty of the damage, and then we also have a damage resistance. We work with we work with uncorrelated damage development and fully correlated model uncertainties, and also the damage resistance is fully correlated. So this would mean a system which has been produced, for example, in a batch. The steel has been produced in a batch where there's low or where there's a certain variation, but it's the same batch, and that's why it's somehow correlated. The resistance is fully correlated, but the damage mechanism is not correlated at all, so it can rather occur either here or here. It does not necessarily, it may not be the situation that it occurs only that it occurs at the, in the, to the same extent in both components. It is rather random. So the first step is to design the structure in terms that we get hold of our component damage probability, and we work here with the target damage probability. I think here the very important point is to get to understand the connection of the problem with Jochen, or not the problem with Jochen, the presentation or the example Jochen has presented. And in this way, Jochen presented a case where we have the one parameter of the structural resistance, and in the design phase we optimize. So this is a real decision analysis. And then there is the reliability-based design. And in the reliability-based design, we are working only with our probabilistic models. We don't have consequence or utility models. And then we compare the reliability of a component performance or of the system performance with the target reliability. And here the decision analysis, like Jochen has presented and you've been implementing, is replaced by a reliability-based design. And this is always the case when you work against or with target reliabilities you find in the Eurocode Zero, or better, better described in the probabilistic model code basis of design from the Joint Committee on Structural Safety. So here we circumvent the or we replace the decision analysis and optimization by accounting for the target reliability. Then, for your understanding, you don't do an optimization and a decision analysis, but the determination of the target reliabilities is a decision analysis in itself. So here, basically, the target reliability has been derived by economic and society optimization for a large set of structures, which was behind the calibration of the Eurocodes. Okay, we are circumvent the decision analysis and calibrate the component probability of damage so that it equals 1 times 10 to the power of minus 2. We can then also calculate the probability of the damage for the system. What is the system model? Pardon?
It's a determinate.
Yeah. So the determinate structure goes to the situation where one component can fail and then the structure is gone. So the it's a serious system for failure. But now we just have a damage model. So it's right, it's a serious system if we consider the failure because of the redundancy. So if I'm modeling this as a serious system, what do I find out when I'm modeling this with a serious system? So
individual probability of failure, first of all, of the component.
this goes in, and if I'm modeling the series system, what situation do I model? What is the meaning? So if I have, the meaning is obvious, it's if I have damage in one component, I have the system damage. So you model basically the occurrence probability of a failure, of a damage in the system. Yeah. If you have a larger system like a wind turbine and you take a series system, then you can model, for instance, the probability of occurrence of a fatigue damage for the complete system. So in any of the hotspots, a damage can develop, and the series system then accounts for all the components. So we can model this as a series system. Then I would like you to derive a probability of indication, independency of the damage size, and you take basis in the slides you have seen by Daniel. And we have a single distribution for the situation where there is a damage A. And this is the mean, and this is standard deviation of a normal distributed signal, and it changes with the damage size. From 0 to 10, please consider this range. And then there is the noise distribution. So the noise is the situation where there is no damage, but there's still a signal or a noise. And this is normally distributed with the mean of 1 and standard deviation of 0.5. So, and then you set the threshold to 1.5. And you can calculate the probability of indication curve. Can you also calculate the receiver operating characteristics? So for the probability of indication, or what is often referred to as the probability of detection, you're changing the damage size. What has changed for the receiver operating characteristics?
We have the PFA. Yeah,
this is what you compute, the probability of detection and false alarm. But what is the parameter? It's the threshold. So you don't fix the threshold if you calculate the ROC. You fix the damage size. Yeah. So the ROC is calculated with fixing the damage size. It's just for one damage size. And the threshold is varied. Okay, yeah, you're welcome to play around with this. It's rather simple, but if you play around, if you you can derive the ROC and the probability of indication and the probability of false alarm here, right? For zero. So now we have a structural performance model in terms of that we are modeling the damage and the damage probability of the components and the system. Now we have also now the inspection performance, and now we can Yeah, this is the symbol for an inspection. You can inspect component one or component two or component one. And you then basically implement the updating. This is one slide of, yeah. This is this slide. Or you could monitor this component. The you do damage load monitoring, yeah? So that's the variable D. And this can be rather straightforward implemented, being aware of the boundaries, but with the one slide I had and using the characteristics of the model uncertainty. Okay, now I stop talking and you start to work. Feel free to ask anytime. Pardon?
Is it identical as the one we had in the previous training school?
Ah, right. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I have worked to do anyway.
You know how it works.
Huh?
You know how it works. Yeah.
Yeah,
but okay. Okay. Yeah. Good point. For the ones who know this problem already, please think about how we can model the steel beam example Jochen did, so that we somehow connect the modeling in this example to the steel beam example. This is the task for the ones who know this problem already. So, and to give a little hint is, we have a structure, yeah, we have one component and we have a probability of failure. But what we measure here is the damage. That's the exercise. So what does the damage mean for the probability of failure? This is what you need to think first about.
In the beam.
Yeah. Yeah, we have here a very generic damage model, basically, yeah, like this one here. And how may this be related to the resistance? This is the first step, and then we can think about of how, when we have this relation and we can model it, then we can think of updating with information about the damage state, like damage loading measurement and an inspection.
What you're asking is what would be the limit state function for each component?
Are you referring to what I, to the second part of the task or to this task?
This task.
Please ask again.
So, I didn't really get the question.
So you update the component damage probabilities with inspection information. And you update the component probabilities with load monitoring information.
For the second part is to connect to open space in with this case?
Yes, yes.
So think about the damage
Yes. Yes, exactly. Well, Lija, maybe you can also help the others, right? In this aspect, yeah. Because you you basically know, right? The direction, yeah.
So, Sebastian, we have an overview of all the input values, and because now we...
I should put this on the file sharing, right?
That would be nice.
Yeah.
summarize on the board. But the second task connected to the example we looked at, the steel beam is very open, right? So I did not do it myself. So I would now start how damage could be considered there. And that's maybe the most straightforward one is we multiply something on the resistance, like 1 minus some A times T. T being the time, right? But then we multiply, and then A, the damage A can be normally distributed, we don't know, right? And we multiply it by time, so it increases in time. So over time, we have a reduction of R, which we don't know. And the problem is when we want to keep it simple from a perspective of reliability assessment, we want to keep it normal. Keep everything normal. So then maybe we don't have a multiplicative decrease of the strengths, but additive. So we just subtract A times T to R. So that's just a new component in the limit state. And that's then normally distributed, so we can still use the straightforward calculus for the reliability. And then it's the question, how do we connect our observation to A? So it's really open, it's really, consider you on PhD level, you make such a task up yourself and demonstrate how this could work on this example.
So we have a task from the lecture. Task, what you see on the slides. We have an alternative task of the ones who are familiar with this example to work further and connect this example to the steel beam example. And point number three, this as introduced by Jochen, and maybe it's a good point in time to introduce your report task. So three different things. But maybe it's good also to have an orientation already on the report task. This is what Jochen talked about. So we would be very happy if you could use the methods you have learned here and apply this to a topic of your own interest, of your own research. This would be the ideal case, and then also we would help you to progress in your PhD research work. So this is for us the ideal case where we are both profiting most.
Okay, yeah. Then even I misunderstood. Then even I misunderstood. So there are two things. There's this task and the report.
As well. We have three different things. This what is here, the connection between this example and the steel beam, mm-hmm. and then the report task. Okay. The ideal report task is that you do it on a topic of your own research. But if in case you cannot find this, we have an alternative task, and this is basically the task number two, where we relate this to the steel beam example. Yeah. So if you cannot find something in your research where you can apply this, then you take basis in the steel beam example from Jochen and in this example, and you try to connect it. So,
regarding that second task, it's still a bit open, I think.
Yes.
So, should we kind of make up, because we need to make some assumptions, so we don't have, we're not constrained by nothing more than theorize about how to connect and describe.
Yeah, well, let's work with it's no constraints, but yes, scientific and good reasoning, and yeah, we would be happy to support you in your thinking. Yeah. Yes.
From yesterday, we've learned quite a number of different methods. There's vision networks, decision analysis, this structural reliability. Now, the personal task, does it have to incorporate everything?
Nope.
Or you can just pick one section that you're really interested in. Let's say vision network and decision analysis and write a report based on that.
So you're free to choose to select the methods you would like to work with. But it must be for the report task, it must be a value of information analysis. So what we do here, we are just working with the reliability. So there's no decision scenario. So the report task is about the value of information analysis and to utilize the methods you have been learning here. But you start, like we started in the first lecture, with setting up a decision scenario. So that you have the structural performance, you have somehow the structural information model, and you have the consequences and you have the actions. You need all these. I think it was good to take it to talk about it already now. We will talk maybe a few times tomorrow again about this, and we will also help you to set up your case, your report task. Yeah. Calculating the probability of indication for dependent on the damage size. So on the slide where you have the on the slide where there's task two, you have the signal distribution and the noise distribution. And the signal and then the signal distribution depends on the damage size on A. So for each damage size A, you have a distribution and you have a fixed threshold. And if you integrate this part of the distribution, it's the probability of no indication given A. And if you integrate this part of the distribution, you calculate the probability of indication for the crack size. Crack size or damage size. Yeah? So this is explicitly written here. And of course, no indication and indication are complementary events. So you can have this even more simple. You don't have to integrate twice. So then you have a state where there's no damage, and then you have the noise. So this is this distribution. And it's usually below the threshold, or I think Daniel Straub had it in the other way around, because for his specific technology, it was the other way around. So you have a high, what was it, a high voltage for the passive case and a low voltage for the active case. But it's the basic principle is the same, but you need to understand your threshold. So the threshold defines whether there is a damage or no damage, or whether there should be an indication or no indication. So here we have, in the technology, we have the case that the signal you see this from the distribution. The signal increases, the mean of the signal increases for a larger damage, and the standard deviation decreases for a higher damage. Yeah. And the in the reference state or the undamaged state where A is zero, it's simply that that we have a fixed distribution of the signal.